Our second speaker is Dr. Silvia Cerino. She's a brilliant researcher in this field. Currently, she's a Marie Curie postdoctoral fellow at MySpace Lab. And she has been working with one of the pioneering groups in the field of virtual reality, led by Professor Giuseppe Riva in Milano, the Istituto Oncologico. And now she's doing exciting research on the role of the body in virtual experiences. And virtual reality not only allow us to simulate worlds and spaces, but also other bodies and identities. And today she's going to talk about all the opportunities that this perspective has in the field of psychology. Thank you very much.
Okay, first of all, thank you so much for the invitation. It is a great pleasure for me to be here. And thank you to all of you for being here with me. Thank you also, Rosa, for the presentation. I think that it's completely clear. I am a postdoctoral researcher at the Department of Psychology at the Università Cattolica del Sacro Cuore in Milan. And yes, I work with Professor Riva. And as you can see, the title of my presentation today is Virtual Reality as an Embodied Technology, Experimental Studies and Clinical Implication. So today in my presentation, I will describe the role of virtual reality as a powerful tool to experimental manipulate in a controlled setting our bodily experience. And then I will describe which are the clinical implications of this powerful tool. After that, I will show you, I will discuss with you which are, in our opinion, some innovative direction in this research field. So to introduce the role of virtual reality as an innovative technique to manipulate our bodily perception, I think that the starting point is to recognize that how we experience our body is a central topic in cognitive science. And although we experience our body and the surrounding space as something relatively stable in our daily life experience, evidence collected up to now suggested instead for the malleability of both space and body perception. And researchers have started to use a specific technique to manipulate in a controlled way the characteristic and the boundaries of the plasticity of our bodily experience. And these techniques are known as bodily illusion. Using the words of Moseley, Gallacci, Spence, we can define bodily illusion as a particular technique able to induce a feeling of ownership over an artificial body or body parts that can be used to explore this complex relationship that exists between the representation in our body of our body and the integrity of the body itself. As I think you know, the prototypical example of this powerful bodily illusion is the rubber hand illusion. Here in this figure from Longo and Haggard, you can see a standard setting to induce the rubber hand illusion. The individual sees a touch on the rubber hand, and at the same time perceive the touch on his hidden actual hand. These two sensory inputs, the visual one and the tactile one, are integrated together. This means that our brain perceive these two sensory input together as a single event. And this multisensory stimulation induce in the participant the illusionary experience that the rubber hand is the real one. So usually participant after the rubber hand illusion reported I felt as if the rubber hand were my hand. A After the introduction, sorry, I have a problem with, okay. After the introduction of the aberrant illusion in this research field, there was a growing interest in using and in developing a lot of different bodily illusion. Another very famous bodily illusion is the full bodily illusion. In the full bodily illusion, a simultaneous multisensory stimulation on real and artificial body is provided so that the participant can experience the feeling of being the owner of another fake body. And in this way, in this research field, virtual reality has started to be used as an embodied technology by inducing full body illusion as an analogous to the rubber hand illusion. This is a video showing our virtual reality full body illusion setup. Here you can see that participants are required to wear an head-mounted display to visualize in a first-person perspective the virtual body. Here, I don't know if you can see that the participant visualize in a completely first-person perspective the avatar. The experimenter provide on the actual body of the participant a tactile stimulation. In a synchronous way, so at same times, the participants see the visual input on the avatar body. This multisensory stimulation is able to induce in participant the feeling of being the owner of the virtual body. Here, I would like to emphasize one specific point. Indeed, an increasing number of experimental studies exploiting the potential of body illusion have found specific distortion in the body perception of participants by changing the size of this avatar, of the embodied avatar. For example, we asked participants to embody an avatar with a skinny abdomen. And after this embodiment procedure, our participants reported to perceive their body as smaller. And the same results was found, for example, by Norman and a colleague, when participants were asked to embody an avatar with a larger abdomen. In this case, participants, of course, reported to perceive their body as larger, congruently with the size of the embodied avatar. So this is very important because in this perspective, virtual reality represents not only a tool to generate in participants the illusion of being inside the avatar, but can be used to manipulate our body perception. And as you can imagine, this opened the possibility to exploit this technique to modify our body perception in general, and in particular to modify body size distortion in a specific clinical population, that is eating and weight disorder, where a distortion in bodily experience is a core clinical symptom. So, and there are some studies that exploited the use of such illusion to investigate the aberrant perception of body. For example, Eshkevari and colleagues pioneered the use of the rubber hand illusion in individuals suffering from eating disorder. What they found? They found that an increased plasticity of the bodily experience in patients suffering from eating disorder. In particular, patients experience this illusion in a more intense way in comparison to healthy control on both perceptual and subjective level. And this abnormal response to the illusion interestingly, was found to correlate with the clinical symptom of eating disorder. Another interesting study was carried out by Kaiser and colleagues, who applied the virtual reality full body illusion in a sample of individuals suffering from anorexia nervosa. They found that participants who experienced ownership over a different virtual body reported after the illusion a significant decrease in their body size distortion. And of course, it is a very relevant study in this field. More recently, Porra Garcia and colleague included this embodiment procedure inside a standard cognitive behavioral treatment for a patient suffering from anorexia nervosa. And what they found? They found that this combined treatment, including a systematic and a hierarchical exposure to an avatar, was very relevant for the patient because this combined treatment led to a decrease in the fear of gaining weight, body-related anxiety, body image disturbances, and body-related attentional bias, all important clinical outcome for anorexia nervosa. So to clarify how the introduction of this virtual reality full body illusion works in clinical sample, I would like to discuss with you the results we obtained in a study we carried out a few years ago in a sample of patients suffering from obesity. This is a study we carried out in collaboration with Dr. Federica Scarpina in one of our eating disorder centers. Our sample was composed by 15 female participants with obesity and 15 female healthy participants. The study was carried out to answer to two specific questions. Might virtual reality full body illusion be experienced in obesity? And might this procedure is able to change body representation in obesity? In the figure, you can see our procedure. At the beginning, before the induction of the illusion, participants were asked to complete a body part size estimation task. Then we applied the virtual reality full body illusion in two different conditions. And then I will explain to you in detail why there are two different conditions. The asynchronous multisensory stimulation and the asynchronous multisensory stimulation. After each experimental condition, participants were asked to complete again a body part size estimation task, and they were asked to fill an embodiment questionnaire. Of course, we also evaluated, assess the physical body parts dimension for all participants. So in this study, we used the virtual reality full body illusion that I showed you before in the video. So as I explained you before, participants were asked to wear an head-mounted display to visualize in a first-person perspective a virtual body. Then the experimenter provided a tactile stimulation on participant body. And at the same time, in the experimental condition, participants saw on the avatar body the visual input. This synchronous multisensory stimulation was able to induce in participant the feeling of being the owner of this virtual body. In a counterbalance order, we also include, following the literature, we also administered the asynchronous condition. So we introduced the delay between the tactile stimulation and the visual input. According to the previous experimental studies. In fact, this asynchronous condition can be considered as a control condition. This control condition usually completely stop the illusion. To verify our hypothesis, after each experimental condition, we asked participants, first of all, to fill an embodiment questionnaire. So participants were asked to rate on a 7-point Likert scale their feelings on 3 different subscales: their feeling of ownership towards the virtual body, their feeling of being in the same location of the virtual body, the self-location scale, and their sense of agency over the virtual body. To see if there was a change in body representation before and after the induction of the illusion, we administered also a body part size estimation scale, a SOR task. Participants were asked to report their perception as concerned their body, as concerned both the circumference of 3 different body parts, shoulder, hips, and abdomen, as concerned, sorry, the circumference and the length. What we found, the main results? We didn't find a difference between the 2 groups, the group of these participants, the group of healthy individuals, as concerned the feeling of embodiment. So we can say that the virtual reality full body illusion was successfully induced in individuals with obesity with the same strength of healthy weight individuals. We can also say that the illusion was successfully induced, in particular as concerned the feeling of being in the same spatial location as the avatar. You can see that participants reported a stronger feeling to be in the same spatial location of the avatar in the experimental condition, the synchronous one, with respect to the control condition, the asynchronous one. So we can conclude that the virtual reality full body illusion could be induced also in a sample of participants suffering from obesity. As concerns the potential changes in bodily experience, these are our main results. After the asynchronous, but not the asynchronous condition, with respect to the baseline, we found a decrease in the misestimation as concern the hips circumference. Here you find we have reported the percentage of misestimation. That is an index computer taking into account the estimation of the body perception in respect to the actual body size parts. So a negative result suggested an underestimation, while a positive result suggests an overestimation. So as concerns the hips circumference, you can see that there is a decrease in the overestimation from the baseline to the asynchronous condition for all the participants. As specifically, as for the specific sample of obese participant, we found also a decrease in misestimation for the shoulders. So we can conclude that this procedure can induce some changes in some specific body parts for the sample of the obese. So, literature reviewers so far suggested that the adoption of this procedure can reduce body size distortion in eating disorder and also in obese participants. But of course, results obtained so far are still preliminary and not completely satisfactory. For example, also in the study that I presented, we obtained some changes for some specific body parts, for example, a reduction in the overestimation specifically for the hips, that of course we can say that is a very emotional body parts, and it is also the body parts that is displayed during the illusion, but not for all body parts measured. And also there is no, at the moment, very few studies measured the long-term change that can be induced by this procedure. So, of course, future study are needed to measure the potential role of this procedure to change body experience for this specific clinical population. And in particular, we suggest that new theoretical driven paradigms are needed to facilitate the update of an aberrant body experience in this clinical population. We started from a particular theory, the allocentric clock theory, to develop a new protocol. This is a very complex theory developed by Professor River in the last year. To summarize the main points of this theory, we can say that according to the allocentric clock theory, individuals suffering from eating disorder may suffer from a specific impairment in their ability to update the stored body memory with the new input coming from perception. This means that patients suffering from eating disorder may be locked into this negative image of their body that the perception is not able to update even after a demanding diet or a significant weight loss. So if this process is impaired for either exogenous, for example, like level of stress, or endogenous causes, for example, alteration in some specific brain areas, the experience for the patient is that their body is locked to an old memory. So we started to think how to facilitate the update of this stored negative body memory. And we decided to build a protocol that combines an hierarchical exposure to a normal body in two different perspectives, first person perspective and third person perspective, with a new technique, the autobiographical recall of body-related experience. So our main aim is to facilitate the update of the stored negative old memory of the body. So in each virtual reality session, patient will embody the avatar in two different perspectives, the first person perspective and the third person perspective. Then we will use a hierarchical exposure towards a normal body. So the body mass index of the virtual body will be changed throughout the virtual reality session. So in the first virtual reality session, the BMI will be the same as the real BMI of the patient. And then this will be increased throughout the experimental session until reaching the considered normal BMI. The last piece of this puzzle is the introduction of the autobiographical recall emotion induction procedure. So patient will be asked to recall a negative emotional episode of their life when they will be exposed to a low BMI avatar. And then at the end of the protocol, they will be asked to recall a positive emotional event when they will be exposed to a normal BMI. So this is a general outline of our protocol. We plan to recruit 30 young women with anorexia that will be randomly assigned to treat specific condition. The protocol will last 4 sessions. Of course, at the beginning, at the end, patient will be evaluated at both perceptual and emotional level. And expected outcome, of course, it's an increase in their perceptual and emotional bodily experience. So, we hope that this multidimensional approach could advance our understanding of embodied properties of virtual reality and may offer a new innovative view of how body is related to embodied emotional feelings. Thank you so much.
Thank you so much, Silvia, for so inspiring presentation. Thank you.